Hello, everyone. I'm Some Dumb American, and I'm here with Bae, and welcome to Book Club with Bae. Say hi, Bae.
Hi, Bae.
So today we're discussing Bloodbound, which is the second book in the Mercy Thompson series. And if you missed our stream about Mooncalled, no worries. The link to our book club playlist is down in the description. If you would like to read my writing, the link to part one of the Volk Saga is down in the description too, so you can see what I'm like. And people have told me I'm pretty good.
You should read it because Dimitri is, I think, one of my all-time favorite MCs.
He's just so much fun because, like, I really like having a pro tag that I don't have to be worried about whether or not he does the right good thing. That has been so much fun for me. Anyway, Bloodbound.
Yes, Bloodbound.
I know it's 6 a.m, but unfortunately, my best friend is in Australia, so here we are.
Well, our next one's going to be at a, I guess, depending on your time zone, more reasonable hour.
Yeah, because we're going to do another one after the nightly stream tonight about the Covenant series, and we're going to be talking about the Half-Blood, the first book, and we're just going to tack on the novella with it. Because the novella prequel really should have been the first couple of chapters, but that's not what we're talking about right now. So, as I understand it, you have now binge read all the published books.
Yes,
that's
I have.
Good, right?
You know what? Because I think when we were talking recently, and you may have forgotten this one book, I'm not sure. But you said that this was probably one of your least favorite in the series.
Mm-hmm. Which one was
my least favorite was, I can't remember the name of it. It's the one where
spoilers, by the way.
Spoilers. Obviously, we're talking about a series.
Yeah.
The one with this water monster thingy.
I forget where she meets Coyote.
Where she meets Coyote.
Rivermarked. Yeah, Rivermark took me a while to get through because I was just like, I'm glad that we'll talk about Rivermark when we get to Rivermark because that's book six. So let's start off with rating the book and what we thought so far. I know that I would give the book, honestly, we gave Mooncalled 4.5 out of 5 stars.
Yeah.
Both of us did. I would give Bloodbound, after rereading it, 3.8 stars.
I'd probably go with a 4.
Okay.
I liked it because I found this the whodunit aspect of the plot quite intriguing. I liked that. So that made up for some of the bits that were a bit like, oh, come on, hurry up.
Yeah, the pacing was interesting. The plot in this one is far less convoluted, which is good. I like the vampires in this, but I don't. And that's probably why book 4 also involves a lot of vampires, and I really enjoyed that one.
Which one was that one?
Bonecrossed. It's the one with James Blackwood. That one is really, really good. I just don't enjoy the parts with the seethe and with the vampires. It's just not my thing. I don't know why. Yeah. I'm not a big fan of the system. So whenever they go deep into vampires, I just not a fan. That being said, I still think it's 3.8 stars out of 5. And reading it, even though it wasn't my favorite, it was still good enough for me to be like, I'm so ready for the next one.
Yeah.
So that's a good thing. So what about you?
I think you're right. Like there's not a lot of vampires in the series that
there's
I like.
Interference with your mic.
Oh, that would be my phone near it. Is that better?
You'll just have to talk for a couple seconds. It doesn't happen all the time.
Yeah, I think my thing with it was it's a very vampire heavy book, but it's not a Stefan heavy book. And yeah. He's pretty much the only vampire you kind of really want to read about.
Yeah, and so I guess we should explain the dynamics of the vampires. Yes. Because I know that a lot of you just enjoy listening to us stream, so so we can sort of talk about Marsilia, because the vampires are sort of, they live in communities, sort of, and they have, like, a hierarchy of vampires. So Marsilia is this takes place in the Tri-Cities in East Washington, so Kennewick, Richland, Pasco, about an hour away from Spokane. Marsilia is the mistress of the seed in the Tri-Cities area. And Marsilia is interesting.
She's an odd
puppy. So she's an old vampire. Peter, hi, I see you. Hi, Peter.
Sorry, Peter, hi.
So she's an old vampire from the Renaissance in Italy, and she got banished by basically the lord of all the vampires 200 years ago, and they got sent to live in a desert. And when they get sent to live in a desert, it means that, like, that was pretty much like their death sentence. Now, Mercy Thompson is a coyote shifter.
Yes.
And the coyote shifters can, or shifters in general, because later in the series you learn that there are, like, hawk shifters and all that kind of stuff. But shifters can see ghosts, and basically, if you want to find out where a vampire lives, even though they can hide from you, you can basically find all their ghosts around their house during the day. And so walkers, which is what they call them, they're not really walkers, though, because, like, they're skinwalkers in the Southwest, and this is, like, real Native American lore, where they skin an animal, and then they can turn into that animal and bring disease. That's not what Mercy is. She can just shift into a coyote. And essentially, she can... vampires. Thank you, Matt. I love Mag Bastard. He's great.
Me too. I'm glad he's back.
By the way, Maggie, when you disappeared, I was, like, so devastated. So don't do that again. anyway. So walkers can basically track down and kill vampires. So the vampires pretty much hunted them to extinction. So that's another thing that's kind of important. So basically how it works is Marsilia has a bunch of vampires under her. Basically, if you're not a really strong vampire, you can't live outside the seas. And what you have to do is basically live near your mistress or master of the seas and drink a little bit of their blood and kind of be sustained by them. But there are a couple vampires in her seas that are more powerful. So there's Stefan, who is, like, a main character sort of in the series. Then there's... Then there's Estelle and Bernard, who become antagonists later, more antagonistic than they are now. Then there's Wolf, who is, like...
Oh, actually, I do like Wolf.
I like... Wolf is interesting. So Wolf got turned when he was, like, 15. And in this series... Creepy. In this series, both vampires and werewolves are immortal. But werewolves, like, even if you're 80 and dying of cancer... If you become a werewolf, you don't freeze. You
go back to, like, your prime.
Yeah, you go back to, like, your prime and all that kind of stuff. So it's basically like you get a really nice makeover. And if you're a vampire, though, you just freeze. So you don't get to be pretty. You're just, if you were, like, 90 when you returned, that's it. So that's an interesting difference. And I think it's because vampires dead when they turn, but a werewolf, you come close to death, and then you...
Recover.
And then you recover, and that's how you change. So, anyway, Marsilia is the mistress of the seed, and Stefan is basically, like, her favorite. Her right hand. And there's also Andre, by the way. Andre is another one. And Andre and Stefan are friends. So let's, I guess, go through the newer characters. So I don't know how much we talked about Stefan in the last one. I think we kind of forgot because a moon call isn't that big of a deal.
Yeah, we briefly mentioned that he exists, and that's about it in the first one. So Stefan, like you said, is Marsilia's like fave, and he seems to have a lot more humanity than a lot of the other vampires. He's quite fond of Mercy.
He's in love with Mercy, which annoys me. That's not. It's like sort of hinted at in Bloodbound, but holy shit, it's so weird and stupid to me. Like you guys know, I hate love triangles.
Yeah, and like she keeps pointing out as well, she's not really the most like. I don't think she's just being self-deprecating. She's not pretty.
Yeah.
She always says she's not pretty, and based on the cover art, no, she's definitely not.
I mean, they pretty her up in the cover art later.
Oh, do they?
Yeah. Well, you see it in, like, I don't know.
Oh, yeah. I haven't really paid attention to it.
Yeah, the cover art later gets prettier, but she's not pretty in a lot of the cover art in the beginning. Like, I would say she doesn't get pretty until...
She doesn't even look half native in the first few books cover art.
Well, yeah.
Or Moon Cold, at least.
She doesn't really get pretty until Rivermarked, and then she, you know, I don't know. And the cover art's weird to me because you get the impression that Mercy dresses fairly conservatively.
In the books, yeah.
And then the cover art is just her in like all these sexy poses, and she's continually like the least sexy person ever.
And why is like... I don't know if this changes later as well, because I couldn't be bothered fixing up the audiobook stuff, so it's all just in one, and it's just shares one cover on my phone.
Mm-hmm.
But like she has in the books, it only mentions that she has a coyote paw print tattoo.
It's mentioned but she's like in Mooncalled. That she has more.
Oh, okay. Well, in later books, it only really ever mentions that one tattoo. And I'm looking at it, I'm like, is she actually this heavily tatted up? And if so...
Yeah, she is in the books.
Okay.
It's only mentioned once or twice. But...
Yeah.
So she has a paw print on her, like, right below her navel. Here, you know, I'm going to show you guys. Sorry, this isn't more polished, but this is, I mean,
we don't use OBS, okay? Fuck.
Well, and this is just like us talking about a book, so it's not like, so this is, you can see there her paw print.
And oh God, honestly, that jaw, they couldn't, I really wish they'd found a better.
But then you can see, I don't know. Let's just go with like Night Broken because that one is a. Then you can see like they've kind of because her figure isn't that nice in that one either. But you can see like they pretty her up and like
they boob her up a bit more as well.
Yeah, so you know, but anyway, so yeah. Stefan.
Yeah, I don't know why everyone's in love with her. I don't.
Well, she's not, I guess we'll just talk about this now. So Stefan's in love with her. Sam is in love with her too. And so is Adam. And again, like I said, when we talked about Mooncalled, I cannot stand love triangles because like to me, if you are willing to wait around for somebody who can't choose between you and someone else, like you have no self-respect.
Yeah.
And honestly, in my opinion, that's, like, not... It doesn't make sense for Adam. Like, Samuel, he's kind of petty, and I don't like him, so I can see it.
Mm.
But Adam is, like, this very straightforward, no-nonsense kind of person. And I just can't see him being caught in a love triangle.
Yeah, it's, I don't know, because, like, each one of them, well, not Stefan, but, like, I understand, Adam being in love with her, because, you know, they actually end up being, spoilers, they actually end up being like, the couple. I understand Sam wanting to be with her because he thinks that she can bear his children. I don't understand Stefan wanting to be with her.
I don't either. It doesn't make any sense to me. And honestly, like, it doesn't add anything to the plot. Like, it doesn't fucking matter.
Like, why couldn't Stefan just be, like, her gay vampire best friend or something?
Well, he doesn't even need to be. He could just be her friend. Like, this girl, other than gay guys and married men, this woman doesn't have any, like, male friends that aren't in love with her. And it's weird.
Oh, or ones where she has, like, a love-hate relationship with.
Yeah, like, she's not just friends with any. So it's an odd. It's an odd, weird thing for, and it kind of makes me lose a little bit of respect for Stefan's character as well.
Yeah, and I think, especially considering what Stefan's arc is in relation to the seed and everything, I think it would have been a bit more, I guess it'd be a bit more dignified for him to be like, well, even if he did initially, like, have a thing for her, to just be like, well, she's never going to want me. Fuck. And move on and go and get himself a hot, undead girlfriend. But he doesn't. He just spends, like, the whole series in love with her.
And it's kind of bizarre. So Stefan is a very powerful vampire. He has the ability to teleport. Yes. Which is not very important in Bloodbound, but it's important later. And he's interesting. So another thing about, so I guess we should keep going with the vampires, and how they work. Another thing about the vampires is that the seethe, the soul of the dragon said she's an urban fantasy protagonist. Of course, everyone's in love with her. Oh yeah. Apparently that carries over from young adult to adult. And I wish it fucking wouldn't.
Oh yeah.
Anyway. So, yeah, so basically, when you get turned into a vampire, until you get, like, super duper powerful, and it takes a long time, you're basically, like, at the behest of like, whoever made
you. Your maker.
Yeah. And Stefan, and so how it works is the vampires have menageries, and they call them sheep. And they feed off the sheep. And Stefan is he has like 14 different people that he feeds off of. And
so he doesn't
kill them.
Yeah, because in this, you can't just have, like, they can't just have like a sip and move on. Like, if you've only got like, say, 3 sheep, they're all going to be dead within a month.
Yeah, and so they get like strays and people who won't be missed from way out of town, and bring them. So that way, like, you don't disturb where you live.
Yeah, you don't shit where you're at. Sorry. Yeah. I'm just trying to
And so essentially what happens is, like, as you keep feeding from them and they take some blood from you, they become bound to you. And basically Marsilia turned Stefan, even though he was bound to a different vampire. So he gave her an oath of obedience, but she doesn't really have power over him. So that creates an interesting relationship between them. Yeah, this is my collection of hobos, pretty much. So I guess we should talk about Stefan's menagerie, because they're characters in this.
Yeah, I think we really only meet three anyway, which is Rachel.
So Peter asked, why aren't they powerful straight away? I guess it's just because they're new and that's just how their vampires work.
That's the law in this universe, Peter. That's why. Fuck.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, like I said, the way that the vampires work in this universe, I'm just like, why is this so fucking convoluted?
I know, because it's also, like, really vague as well. It's like, you know, some vampires only need to feed off of their maker for, like, you know, a few years. Some need to do it for, like, a century.
And some of them have special powers. And honestly, the powers are explained to you before they're used later in the books. So you're not like, vampire bullshit ex machina, what the fuck? But at the same time, it's, like, so convoluted. And like I said, whenever it's a heavy vampire book, and there aren't many of them, thank goodness, but whenever it's a heavy vampire book, I just don't enjoy it as much, which is why I gave it 3.8, because I just don't, and I don't like the vampires, and I don't give a fuck about them. and the lore is convoluted, and it's just not my thing. So, his menagerie. So we meet Naomi, who in the 80s or so.
I think it was in the 70s or 80s.
Yeah, she was a professor in Chicago with leukemia. And she is basically been feeding off stuff and like blood exchanging for a while. And she's kind of an interesting. She's not like. I don't like or dislike her. She's just kind of there. Rachel, Stefan got Rachel when 12?
Yes, because she's like 17 and he's had her for like 5 years.
Yeah, and that's Rachel. Stefan had Daniel in his menagerie and then Andre turned Daniel. Oh, by the way, the reason why a lot of the other ones don't have really big menageries where they try to keep their people alive is because they don't have enough control to do it.
Or enough care to control.
Yeah. So, yeah. Stefan, you know, so you don't get away from, oh, he's a vampire, but he's, like, a nice one.
Yeah.
And virtue signaling vampires are some of my least favorite fuckers in books. Just, if you're going to create vampires, like, create them the way that you want them to behave. Because you obviously, like, want to have a good one, then don't make him a vampire. Like, that's my thing. Vampires, like, vegan vampires are annoying. They're like regular vegans. They're irritating as fuck. Like, you eat people. Stop it. So Rachel is just, like, this chick. Then Daniel is another guy who's in the seed. And Andre, who's, like, Stefan's frenemy, turns him against Stefan's wishes, so they're all, like, grr at each other. Andre is another vampire that's basically on par with Stefan.
I think at some point in the book, they refer to Stefan as Marsilia's right hand and Andre as her left.
Yeah. And Andre ends up being, like, the main antagonist in this book. In my opinion, like, the book, so the major conflict is over, and then you still have, like, 3 chapters left.
Yeah, honestly, she has a habit of doing that. Like, you're like, okay, it's going to wrap up at the end of this chapter, and you're like, oh, wait, no, there's one last final thing we have to tie up for the next 3-4 chapters.
And it's kind of like Man of Steel, where, like, that fight could have been over in 2 seconds, but they make you wait for 20 fucking minutes. For a bunch of bullshit, but we'll get there. So what other characters do we have to go over for this one?
I will say, poor Daniel, bless him.
Yeah.
Poor Daniel. His role in this is pretty much he thinks he deaded a whole bunch of people, but it turns out there were false memories and...
Yeah, we'll get to
then
that.
Then he gets kidnapped and then he gets... Yeah, and then he gets kidnapped, and then he dies, and it's sad.
Yeah, so what else as far as... Ben matters more. I don't know if we talked about Ben.
Oh,
but in the last, so
you
Ben.
know what? I don't like early Ben. I really wish that she'd just done later Ben as early Ben
You
as
know what?
well.
I'll talk about Ben in a second. So, about what I think of Ben. So Ben was suspected of, he's English, he was suspected of rape in England, so they shipped him to America. And Patricia Briggs, who's the author, paints him as this horrible misogynist. And you never see that. Ever. Like, he says the word cunt. And it's
yeah.
He doesn't even say it. It's just alluded to.
Yeah, because one of the things as well is she very, very obviously as well keeps foul language in, like, swearing out of her books.
For the most part.
Very obviously.
Yeah.
She'll even put in, like, 5 times a book. Adam was raised in the 50s and doesn't like using swear words around women, so he doesn't let anyone else do it either. And stuff like that. Like, it's like, okay, fine.
But she paints Ben as, like, this evil misogynist that people need to keep their females away from. And he doesn't act like one.
She might have done a better job at portraying him that way if she would actually let him swear.
But isn't enough. Like, calling somebody a cunt is not enough for me to be like, he hates women and would rape them.
Yeah, because apparently as well, he only ever, I don't know if it's in this book or in one of the other books, but she mentions that he only ever refers to women as that bitch or that cunt or that whatever, like, insert derogatory term here. But again, like you said, you never actually really see it except for the time
where she's blatantly like, remember, he's a misogynist, and you're like, then why don't you just make him one? And it's because she wants to make him likable later. But like I said, Patricia Briggs has some interesting habits. One of them is she likes rapey characters, and she likes rape for whatever fucking reason.
She likes showing how not for rape she is.
And then she, like, for whatever reason, she's obsessed with saying, even, like, when Ben's nice and, like, there's literally nothing. Ben is just snarky. Like, his bad boy stuff is literally just him being snarky. And you're like, this is not a rapey person. Like, you haven't proven to me that he's a misogynist. Like, he just isn't. Like, yeah, he calls somebody a cunt once or twice. Like, give me a fucking break. He's just sarcastic and kind of a goofball. Like, that's all you got.
The worst you could call him is an asshole.
Yeah.
The absolute worst.
But of course, he's like the misogynist of the book, and like, don't let Jessie, who's Adam's daughter, anywhere near him. And it's fucking dumb.
Yeah, especially when you find out his backstory, you're like, oh, Ben.
Yeah, and you're just like, this is stupid. This is so stupid. I really, like, this is something that bothers me. Female authors do this in general. They like to have somebody who's rapey. They, at some point, for whatever reason, throw in an incredibly rapey person for no goddamn reason. Like, so Mercy does martial arts, and the one time we see her in class, it's after in the third book she gets raped. I'm sorry, like, I know we're jumping ahead, but in the third book she gets raped. And everybody knows about it, so in the fourth book, I think, we have to fucking watch her in a martial arts class, and then there's just random guy who likes rapey stuff. And you're like, this is just
He never gets mentioned again.
Yeah. He's never mentioned before that. He's never mentioned again. That's the only time we see her doing, like, her martial artsy stuff. And it's just, it's fucking stupid. Like, and these are just tropes that I don't like about female authors, that they have to, remind you that women, like, and like we said last time, every 5 seconds in these books, it's, the werewolves are still stuck in the 20th century. I'm challenging stuff, even though I'm not. Ben's a misogynist, and you're just like, Why?
I know. But you know what, though? It really, really, really shows credit to her writing that she's such a blatant virtue signaler, but we still just love these books.
Right, because like those are my that's my complaint about these books. My complaint about these books is not the pacing, it's not the storylines. It's just if she says one more feminist thing, I'm gonna scream. But I love the books.
You know what, though? I found in the later books there's a bit less of that.
There's a lot less of it. Another thing
Yeah.
about her writing, and I don't like this about sequels, where she constantly reminds you who major characters are.
She doesn't do it as often as, or as bl like in your face as a lot of other authors,
But it's
but
still
yeah.
in your face. And see, when I write and I'm writing like a sequel, like I just assume that you've read the fucking first book.
Yeah, I think there's times where it's appropriate, and because these books do actually have a very large cast across the
Yeah, but
entire
like, you know,
series.
they do. And
And
if it's a minor character who becomes a major character, I get it.
yeah,
But do we
because
really need to be
sometimes also
reminded?
characters go missing for like a book and a half, 2 books.
Yeah, and that
But
makes sense to me. But do we have to be
yeah,
reminded every single second
who
that,
the fuck Stefan is?
yeah, or that like, hey, here's the gay werewolves. It's like, hey, I get it. Because like, she'll do it halfway through the book too. You saw Daryl say something earlier in the book, and then all of a sudden it's like, by the way, Daryl, Adam's second. It's like, I know who fucking Daryl is.
Yeah. Oh, and in case you've forgotten, since the last time I mentioned it, he's half black and half Chinese.
Yeah, and it's like,
And
I
she mentions
know.
Daryl's race so much.
Yeah, she does. So Uncle Mike is more important in this book as well.
Oh, Uncle
Uncle
Mike.
Mike is this Irish tavern owner. So the Fae are, like I said, instead of being like, how do they hide all this shit from humans? It's like, well, they don't. So the Fae are like out, and Uncle Mike just has like this tavern that has magic, so the humans don't want to go to it. Where like the Fae, it's pretty much like a Fae safe space. And so he's more important in this book, and he's kind of like an important background character in the other books as well. Z is more important in this book too. I like Z;
I
he's one
love
of my
C.
faves. Who else gets important?
I know that. Well, Gabriel is really kind of properly introduced in this book, but he's not that important in it
Yeah,
from
Gabriel,
memory.
so Z's son Tad used to like help her at her garage. And now Gabriel does. And Gabriel is just like this high school aged Mexican who's dating Jesse. And that's about it.
Yeah.
So he's important later, but he's not important now. So let's
He's a
just,
likable character, though.
yeah, he is. I like Gabriel a lot. Most of the characters I don't hate. And
No.
Honey's in this book, isn't she?
Yes, this is the first because
Honey,
I love
overall,
Honey.
I fucking adore Honey. I love
Oh.
her so much.
Yeah.
She is one of my favorite characters. And she's important later too. And later, see, because I was bitching to you because I was like, she kind of forgot everything about Honey, and I don't get it.
Yeah.
So when I re-listened to Bloodbound, I was like, okay, did I miss something? And I didn't. So she turns Honey in later books into this like anti-women's rights weirdo. But like
Yeah,
in
I
the third
think
book, she says that Honey's salty about not being in a more dominant position in the pack.
it's I think part of it is now that I like know what you're talking about, like, because Honey is she's got a dominant personality, which you know is a normally a high hierarchy advantage in the pack, but she's married to a submissive, and which is kind of interesting in the first place. But then later on in the series, it, yeah, she, you know, she's a dominant, but she's happy being with a submissive and being at the bottom of the barrel.
Yeah, but in book three, Iron Kiss, she's like explicitly says that she's pissed at Mercy because Mercy has a chance to be dominant in the pack.
Yeah, I can't remember whether or not how much of Honey's wishes to be more dominant was just Mercy making assumptions.
Yeah, but there's nothing about that Honey ever tells you later that that's changed.
Yeah, and I think part of it as well is a lot of the Honey was happy being lower down stuff, but now she's kind of being forced up and she's not happy about it. Spoilers again for future books. Her husband dies, and I think part of it is she'd rather be at the bottom of the pack with her husband than at the top without him.
Yeah, but that's not how it's posed. Like I said, whenever it comes to like these feminist issues, she completely drops the ball.
I know. I'm trying to redeem Honey's character here. Okay.
Fuck. No, Honey is like my favorite character. She's probably my favorite character.
I love her
because whenever she's in the book, I'm just like, yay, Honey! I'm so happy. Like that's how I feel about her. I just wish like that Patricia Briggs wasn't stupid with it because it's. Like, the books are so good, and then it's just, like, this random, like, bullshit. It's like, okay, it's like if you were expecting to eat just chocolate ice cream, and then all of a sudden there's coconut in it, and you're just like, what the fuck, why? I want chocolate.
And then it goes back to chocolate, and then every so often you just get a layer of coconut.
and it's so out of place. And like I said, this is a pet peeve of mine with female authors, where the protagonist, everybody's in love with her, and she's just a too good female character. And I'm like, if she's a strong female character, you don't have to fucking tell me. I get it. I can read. Listen, whatever. I got you, boo, okay? I feel ya. It's fine. So let's get into the plot of this.
Okay, and we went... I think we over-explained the plot last time, so we'll try and give as
this plot isn't as convoluted.
No, it's not. Okay, did you want to do it or did you want me to?
Okay, so this one isn't as convoluted, so I don't think explaining it in depth will be confusing because it's not a confusing plot, if that makes sense.
Yeah,
I still don't understand. So in the first book, so just some differences in the plot. The first book, in the plot, a lot of the characters and the antagonists in that one, you never see them again. And it's just really confusing.
Yeah, whereas they're dead, they get mentioned like twice.
Yeah, whereas in this one, the story kind of ties over. And you can tell that this is real, like all these books are really well thought out. And that she thought out,
because it's foreshadowing stuff.
There's it's just like everything ties into everything. So these are very well thought out books, and I really like that because in a lot of times with series, you can just tell that these were not, she did not plan 10 books in advance. And with this series, I could believe that these were all planned before the first one was published. Maybe before the second, not the first one, but before the second one was published, you could convince me that they were all planned in advance.
Yeah.
Because she's very consistent with the lore, and she's very consistent with all that stuff, except for some of the characters, because they have to be feminist, okay? And she has to drive home that she's for women's rights and that the werewolves are totally fucking backwards.
But so they eventually start to get there.
She's just fucking dumb. Yeah, because, like, real quick, later in the books, Bran, who's, like, the Marok, has to cut off their pack.
Mm.
And, like, and he's like, you know, because... you guys have made enemies because, like, Mercy has been challenging the pecking order of the pack. And, like, she fucking hasn't been. Female werewolves get their rank from their mates, okay? So her being like, Arielle is technically like 2.5 in the pack. Like, that's her rank. It's like, yeah, duh. That is not... That's not like, you're not changing anything. You're just pointing out the fucking obvious. So, I'm sorry.
I know, right?
Like, she doesn't change anything, but it's like, oh, well, the other packs hate you because you're not challenging jack shit. Anyway, so the plot. So, it starts off, why is Stefan in her debt? Why is she in Stefan's debt again? What did he do for her in Moon Call?
She drove a dead body around in his van. Okay. Is that what it was?
I don't even remember. So just for whatever reason, from the events in Moon Call, like I said, I don't fucking remember because Moon Call was convoluted as all fucking get out. Still gave it 4.5 stars because it was just that good. But still, convoluted as hell. You should you should listen to the Moon Call stream after this and just listen to us like trying to figure out what the fuck the plot is of that book. Because we're just like, I don't know. Anyway.
But again though, with Moon Cold though, when you're actually reading it, it didn't feel like that until you actually went back and went what the actual plot is, and then it's just like, holy yeah. Fuck, I don't know what I just read.
And like I said, later books, it's amazing how consistent she is because there are so many moving parts to the plot.
Mm.
And it's
so many subplots.
So Bloodbound. So Stefan shows up and is like, by the way, this takes place 6 months or so, because like Moon Call takes place over like Thanksgiving week, and Bloodbound takes place that next summer.
Or beginning of summer, I think. Yeah, I think. Yeah and I think
that summer.
Yeah, and I think, like, the 10 books that have been released so far take place over about, like, four years, maybe?
3 or 4, yeah.
3, yeah.
So the spacing of stuff is good.
Good.
Unlike House of Night, where everything takes place over, like, 3 fucking months. Anyway. So Stefan shows up and is like, I have this harness, turn into a coyote, we're going to see a thing.
It was really weird. Like, I can remember when the first time I read it, I misheard her saying, because I can remember her going, I could always just wear my own collar. And I missed part of it. So I assumed she was wearing her one. Mm-hmm. And then later on, she's like, if I'd been wearing mine, I would have been able to escape. I'm like, what the fuck? And then I literally had to go back because I was really confused and I couldn't get past it. I thought Patricia Briggs fucked up, but I fucked up.
Yeah, so she's wearing this harness, this leather harness, and she's in coyote form because they're going to go check something out. So they go to this hotel. There's this guy there named Corey Littleton.
And a bad smell.
And a bad smell. Very bad smell. They make sure that you know that it smells like crap. It smells bad. You remember that it smells bad because you need to know that it stinks.
And every paragraph will tell you.
It fucking stinks. So Corey Littleton is a sorcerer. And basically he invited a demon into his body and he's a vampire. So he's like a big wig, like magical person, whatever. And he's basically, like, killed all the staff and everybody's staying at this motel. And so they go in and they talk to him and he's like, and then he, like, takes over Stefan or something. And then Maid dies and then Stefan's like, I think I killed somebody. And you're like, okay.
No, you did it.
And she's like, nah. And he's like, I think so. And you're like, whatever. Sorry. That's pretty much what happens.
It is.
So then at some point, for whatever reason, Steph has to sleep in her closet.
Because he didn't have enough, I think, energy to go poof. And he didn't have enough time to run away.
Yeah, so he has to go sleep in a closet. And she's like, I want to go to bed, but Stefan's in there, and so I'm gonna not go to bed instead of going to sleep in one of the other rooms like a fucking normal person.
Yeah,
God,
sleep on the fucking couch.
it sounds like I'm bitching. I really like this book. I'm sorry. It's just like when you talk about it, like I've tried to take notes for Bloodbound, but I'm like, I don't hate it enough to take notes.
No.
So,
Oh, I'm looking forward to our next stream, speaking of, but
Anyway, so
anyway.
then what happens next? What even happens next?
Oh fuck, what does happen next? Stefan's dead in the closet and she oh frig.
She
I can't remember
something.
now.
I don't remember what the fuck happens. But
I
then
know
at
she
some
goes to
point,
work really tired at some point. I
right.
think it's then. I think she goes to work because she's just like, well, everyone's
Okay, and
like,
there's this,
Stefan's dead.
like I said, there's this weird subplot with this like random reporter guy who like
Oh,
has a
yes. And then you
daughter.
never hear about it again.
Yeah, he's got like this 13-year-old daughter who's a werewolf and he doesn't know what to do with her, and so she's like, take her to Bran or whatever, and then it's over. And it's like the dumbest, and like it's not a dumb subplot, but like it doesn't fucking matter. It changes nothing. And it's like, why are you
Yeah.
wasting my time with a subplot that means nothing? Anyway.
Yeah. Well, I think that's actually what happens next. His character's introduced. She goes to the shop and he's there.
Oh yeah, okay. That's fine. So there's just that random subplot. We're not gonna talk about it again because it doesn't fucking matter. But yeah. And then I don't even remember why Adam starts giving her guards.
Because of the sorcerer dude.
Yeah, but like it doesn't make sense to me, I
Wait,
guess.
give
It's
me.
just, I think that's why. I don't think you're wrong.
Yeah, I think he was pissed off and up. He was because he was furious that she went with Stefan, and she's like, "Well, you know, too bad, so sad. I'm gonna do what I want."
And so he's like, now you have werewolf guards. And you're just like, all right, whatever. But Honey's her werewolf guard, and I love Honey, so I'm okay with it.
Yeah.
So that subplot's just, it's just kind of there. It doesn't, like I said, it doesn't matter, but it's a thing.
Yeah, and
And Sam, the weird thing about this is like there's supposedly like this love triangle going on. But Sam and Adam aren't really even in this book.
yeah, because
So.
it does Sam doesn't go missing too, does he? I can't remember.
No, he does. See, you don't
Oh, he
even
does.
listen. I don't give a fuck about
Oh,
Sam.
there
I
we
hate
go.
Sam.
Yes, because yeah, they end up at some point. That's right. She ends up go like after that day, and she meets the reporter dude that has the werewolf daughter thingy. She go step. Nightfall, Stefan wakes up, goes poof back home. And they know that they're gonna have to go and see Marsilia that night. So I don't think Adam goes, does he?
No,
Because it.
she takes Ben, right? Ben and Warren, I think.
I don't know. She goes with two other wolfies to go see Marsilia. And give testimony because Adam won't let her go on her own. I'm pretty sure. And that's where we meet Wolf, and there's the truth chair thingy.
Yeah.
That Wolf runs. So the vampires, because werewolves can tell when people are lying and stuff, except for vampires because they're dead. So they don't have the physical.
Telltales of lying.
Yes. And so they've got a magical chair thing because Wolf is a wizard, which is different to a sorcerer because I think a sorcerer has to have a demon to be a sorcerer or something, or a sorcerer is the only thing that's capable of getting a demon into them. I can't remember. It's related to that. Whereas Wolf can just do magic stuff. And
well, that's just like his thing that he can do.
Yeah. And
doesn't make a ton of sense.
He does blood magic. So he can, when you sit on this chair, you slam your hands down on these stabby things, and through the chair, he can taste your blood and work out if you're lying or not.
Yeah.
Because Stefan thinks he killed the maid, but he didn't actually kill the maid, and Mercy knows that he didn't kill the maid, it means that Daniel, the other vampy poo, probably didn't kill all the people he thinks he killed.
Yeah.
So they have to give testimony and walks like, well,
so yeah. How the Daniel thing starts is whenever any vampire comes to town, they go check out who the fuck it is and are like, give us money. Or they're like basically a fucking mafia, and it's dumb. Like I said, I don't enjoy the vampire lore, so forgive me for that. So Daniel goes, and it's this Corey Littleton guy, and it's like a pretty safe assignment for like somebody who's like an underling, like newly turned, no power whatsoever. But of course, as it turns out, oops. And so now
it's a sorcerer, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah. So when Wolf basically says Stefan, he's not like he thinks that. He believes that he remembers it this way, but he doesn't believe that it's what actually happened.
Yeah.
So get Mercy on the chair, and it's like this whole thing, because Mercy is like kind of immune to vampire magic, but this isn't vampire magic, so does it work? Does it not work? It's a bunch of bullshit.
And then, and I think the only reason they end up believing her is because Stefan manages to convince them that she was in coyote form. This guy had no reason to believe she was anything other than a coyote, because even to supernatural beings, unless you know what you're smelling for, she smells like a coyote.
Yeah.
And not like a walker. So.
So.
He had no reason to channel his magic at her. So.
Yeah. So basically after that, she's kind of just hunting the vampire for a while, or hunting Corey Littleton. There's like a wave of crime and like a wave of.
Oh, that's right. Sorry, I just remembered, because then she did take Warren and Ben, because then they decide Stefan has 4 weeks to find Corey Littleton to prove that what him and Mercy are saying is true. Mm-hmm. And Daniel has to help, even though he's like been tortured for weeks and is like on the verge of death. Mm-hmm. And Warren and Ben are like, well, we'll help too. And so the four of them kind of team up to try and find Corey Littleton.
Right. Yeah. Have I heard of Sanderson's Law? No, I haven't.
What's a Sanderson's Law? I'm going to Google it.
Yeah, Google it. I don't know what it is. So, right. Okay.
Which, the Sanderson's laws of magic with multiple laws. We're going to need a bit more elaboration for it.
I guess it's like basically how to write a magic system.
Could come in handy.
Honestly, this is like, okay, so just skimming. This is just common sense. Like, I don't know why somebody got a law named after them. It's just like fucking duh. I don't know. To me, it's just like no fucking shit. Like, maybe this just proves that people who shouldn't be writing stuff are writing stuff. If you need to be told that kind of stuff, it's like, yeah, think it out. Make sure it doesn't suck. Fucking duh. Anyway, so. I'm not bitching at you, by the way. I'm just, like, I'm surprised that needs to be a thing. But given how shitty a lot of magic systems are, I get it. And I'm just like, maybe people shouldn't be authors. I should be the only author, obviously. Anyway, that's a joke, by the way. So they, like, go out and look for him. They have 4 weeks to do it.
Brandon Sanderson is legit the best fantasy writer ever, so that might be why I just wagering a guess. Well, I'm sorry, I've never heard of the guy, so I can't agree or disagree with that.
Yeah, I've never, I don't.
Foxy ridden.
I mean, honestly, if, like I said, if you are making a magic system and these aren't things that you just instinctively know to do, maybe you're not a good writer. Just a thought. Like, if this is not just duh to you, stop writing.
He's literally written one book.
Anyway.
Sorry.
Sorry. So they are like searching, and of course Mercy can't, and she's like, because what can I do? I'm just a walker. I don't have supernatural stuff. I just turn into a coyote. And you're like, whatever. So at some point, like, really, now that I think about it, she's like sleuthing on her own, but the rest of the middle part of the book doesn't really matter that much.
No, it doesn't.
Like, it's just, here's some sleuthing. Okay, go to chapter 10. Now here's the fun stuff. Sorry. I need to stop reading chat because it's distracting me. Right. So then, like, everybody goes missing. And so she's like, now I have to find them. And so she calls Gabriel's sister, and she's like, where's a churchy thing, because something, something, whatever. So Gabriel's sister's like, there's an abandoned church over there. And she's like, all right, here I go. So she goes to the fucking church, right?
And then she sees all the ghosty poos.
And then she sees all the ghosts. And she goes in, and there everybody is. Oh, by the way, at some point, Z and a bunch of the other Fae give her a stake. They give her Z's knife from the first book that can cut through anything. And then they give her a medallion that
she says dragon, and it
burns,
incinerates.
So
yeah,
she gets there. Ben, Sam. Oh, also Sam has a sob story at some point. Who gives a fuck? His girlfriend at one point got an abortion from like a while ago. I just don't fucking care.
That is kind of important though, because it leads up to.
Oh yeah. So at some point, Sam's a fucking doctor, and like there's a baby that's half dead. He wants to eat the baby. He comes home. He's like, and then Mercy's like, what's wrong? And he's like, my girlfriend had an abortion. You're like, all right, fuck, I don't give a shit. I hate Sam. I'm sorry. It's not, I'm not making fun of abortion. I just don't like Sam. Anyway. So, God, Daniel sucks. So they're all, like, in cages, in, like, these magical cages. And all the wolves are crazed except for Adam. And Stefan's there, too. And at some point, Mercy gets flung and gets ouchied. And she has, like, the stake in her hand. And Stefan, like, so, what does he do? And Andre gets kind of captured or whatever. He takes Andre and Ben and has them, like, fight. So, Stefan, yeah. So Mercy's all like, ow. And so Stefan, like, calls her to him from across the room. She crawls over. They swap blood, and she's like, feels better again. So then he comes back. So then Corey Littleton comes back downstairs. Yeah, nobody cares about your dead baby, Sam, SDA 2017. I really don't give a fuck about his dead baby. I just don't. I do not care about his sob story. So Corey Littleton comes back. She does a stabby on him. Oh, by the way, Marsilia doesn't want Littleton dead. She wants to capture him and make him, like, her pet, which is dumb. And everybody's like, it's kind of dumb. So Andre helps her kill Littleton. I don't know why, given that Andre made Littleton for Marsilia to win Marsilia's favor. But anyway, so...
Sorry, I'm just laughing at the idea of you selling a t-shirt saying nobody cares about your dead baby, Sam.
I didn't even see that. That's funny as fuck.
You okay. should do that. See what happens.
Nobody would know what it means. And that's like the problem. I would if everybody knew what I was talking about. But they don't. So anyway.
Carry on.
So she stabby stabs him and
she stabby stabs him.
And then she cuts off his head and burns his body. And Bran shows up because Bran was, of course, coming to the rescue for God knows what reason. And Bran
he
shows
up. He always rocks up like half an hour late.
Yeah, and so they're like, let's go to the hospital. And I just don't give a shit. And that's pretty much it. Oh, yeah, and then, of course, like I said, it's kind of like Man of Steel where shit's tacked on to the end. And you're just like, I am here for 20 minutes longer than I needed to be. Because then she goes on a vampire hunting spree. And instead of, like, getting the wrong house once, like, I can understand that. But she goes to, like, everybody's house except Andre's. Because Andre wants to make another sorcerer. So she goes to everybody's fucking house except for Andre's. And so we have to watch her, like, oh, that's not the right house. Is it this one? No. Is it this one? No. And then finally
and then we get to randomly driving, and then all of a sudden she just happens to stumble across the right place.
And you're like, this is an hour too late. I'm really irritated right now. And then she kills him because he wants to make another one, and she's like, I cannot let you do that.
And then it's important to know, because he had two people locked up in thingies in his menagerie, and yeah, he's apparently understocked. And she sets them free, and she was going to go out and, like, you know, be like, okay, we'll take you to hospital or something. And she comes outside, and Wolf and Stefan are out there, and they deaded them. Or Wolf didn't, because Stefan wouldn't, because it would upset her. And that's important, because in the next couple of books, she's still holding that against him. But they did it to save her life.
Yeah, and she's like,
because they framed the two deaded sheep people as Andre's killers and not her. Because otherwise it would have started a war of some sort.
Between vampires and werewolves. Is there anything else to the plot?
Like, I think this plot we missed what happened with Daniel. Because Ben's also like all in wolfy form right now. And she has to kind of... Because they'd been taken and for weeks and stuff. And Ben ended up eating Daniel because he was starving.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And she sees Daniel's ghost all traumatized and just kept hearing, he ate me, and didn't click until she saw Ben, and she was like, oh, fuck, Ben ate Daniel, and Ben wouldn't turn back into a wolf and – oh, sorry, turn back from a wolf. And then when she's about to go kill Andre, she's like, it's okay, Ben. I'm going to go kill him for you. And Ben's like, okay. And then he turns back into a human. So she fixes Ben.
Right, but he's an evil misogynist. Don't forget.
Yeah, and then after the next book, you know, there's more of that type of dynamic to their relationship, like to the extreme where they help – where – one of them helps heal the other one. And then in the next book, it's, but Ben's a misogynist, don't forget.
It's annoying. It's like, stop. And honestly, in Iron Kiss, she gets raped, which is the next book, which we'll talk about soon as well, I think, because I'm re-listening to it just to remind myself what the fucking plot of it is. And
I've got something to say when we get to-
I really wish that she didn't have Mercy raped, because we have to hear about it for the next 10 fucking books. And it's just, I don't care. Like, I get that, okay, as a human, right, you have trauma. Because she also has panicky attacks in the next one, too, where she's like, I'm scared of vampires. And you're like, I don't give a fuck. I don't give a shit. Like, I get it. People have trauma. But also get to the goddamn point. And I just don't give a shit. Is there anything else to talk about? Oh, and at the end of the book, so because within like a mile radius or something like that, or like 3 miles or whatever it is, if you're like within that many miles of like where the sorcerer sleeps, like there's like a massive crime wave because it causes chaos. And so Sam's like, I lost control. I should just kill myself. And you're like, please kill yourself. And Mercy's like, no, Sam, it's okay. You've been fighting off the demon for like months now. And he's like, really? And she's like, yeah. And he's like, okay. And you're like, I just don't care. I do not care.
Chat. Okay. Chat.
I don't care about your rate, Mercy. STA 2017. Factory. Yeah, I know. Like, here's the thing about writing, because we have some time before I have to skedaddle. And trauma. Like, it's annoying when they forget that you made something. When an author forgets that they made something traumatic happen to a character.
Yeah.
At the same time, this is also a book, and we've got other shit to worry about. Can you not bother me with the trauma from 5 books ago?
Yeah.
Like I said, I get it. It's important to not be like, I know that you were like brutally raped in the last book, but let's not ever think about it ever again.
But yeah, and I like that she does eventually stop mentioning it.
It takes 5 books.
I know, but then I think though in the last, I have a feeling in the last book she brings it up again. I can't remember if it's the last one or not, but it gets brought up again. Huh?
What was the last one you read?
It was the one that came out in March.
So after Fire Touched?
Yeah.
I haven't read that one yet.
Yeah, I don't know if it's that one or not, but that one is a very, very different book, but Ben has a very good scene in it. He does. I love Ben's scene in that.
Quit quoting me. Like, I sound so awful. We got other shit to worry about. Can you not bother me about that rape? SDA 27. Stop it.
There is a t-shirt suggestion that isn't a quote by you, which is, I love SDA even though she kind of hates me.
Okay.
Yeah, and
you're not wrong that I said that. But at the same time, I sound like
It would really trigger the feminists, which would then give you exposure, which would then boost your channel, which would then actually sell the shirts, and then it would just be a cycle. You should do it for the sake of your channel.
Like, I get it. You made, stop being funny. All right, fair enough. I get it. You give them trauma and they have to, but at the same time, it's a book. And, you know, take some creative leeway. Like, don't completely forget about it, but maybe chill the fuck out. That's all I'm saying. Because she has panic attacks about everything that happens.
I know. She has panic attacks about things that haven't happened. She has panic attacks at the thought of the word vampire because she thinks that the vampires might potentially find out and come and get her.
You almost die in everything. Like, at some point, you either need to, like, I don't know, kill yourself, move away, or just take some Xanax and be done with it, because I can't be fucked. Like, if you're going to be this traumatized by everything...
I'm just laughing at Mag Bastard.
Maybe don't be a protagonist.
Can we just rename this stream series to SDA hates everything in the book but still likes the book?
This is probably my least favorite, except for Rivermarked. Rivermarked and this one are... Rivermarked I might like a little bit less than this one. Because Rivermarked is just slow.
I struggled to pay attention to Rivermarked.
Rivermarked took me forever to get through because I was just not getting through it. I was like...
I'm gonna have to reread it because, like, I would, because I was listening to it, right? Because it's much easier. And after about the 20th time, I stopped going back 20 minutes to re-listen because I just kept missing bits. And I'd be like, wait, they were just at the river. How the fuck did they get in the cabin? Oh, fuck it. I'm sure I'll catch up somehow. That's where I was with that book.
I like River Mark less than this one, but this one was probably my least favorite out of, you know, not like second least favorite.
Yeah, this
one.
We
should have like a rating system.
This one at least had some.
Like in order of like what we, like the order in which we like them the most or something.
But then we have to update it every stream.
Yeah, I know.
Okay,
well. I'm writing it. I'll write it down.
Okay, well, it's pretty simple. It's
Moon Call.
One was.
Blood. Yes. Found. So I'm just like writing this down, but. So far, order of like best to not best, Moon Called, Bloodbound, because we're two books in. But now that you are like pre-baby, don't have to work, we'll probably get this whole series done within like a couple weeks.
Yeah, and yeah, we'll be chucking in some Covenant books in between.
Yeah. Those are short shit, though, thank goodness.
I know, because there's 1, 2, 3. 4 more books and 1 novella that actually is like it's still chronological. It's just a short story and it's from Aiden's perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So we might combine that with the next book, but we might not. We'll see. We'll see what happens.
Okay. So there's not much else to say. Like I said, So let's just go back over the good things because I have trashed the fuck out of this book even though I like it. Because re-listening to it wasn't bad. I didn't enjoy re-listening to it. I just, like I said, the vampire stuff is probably my least favorite because I don't like the vampire she has in the book.
Yeah.
Because, like, to me, vampires should just be, like, lone wolves if you will. And I don't enjoy all the structure that they have to them, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. it just annoys me. Yeah. But the things I did like, the plot is not as convoluted. This is where the series really starts to tie together because like I said, everything, all the lore is very consistent. Everything starts tying together from here on out, and it's good, and I enjoy it.
Yep, and this book, I think, also was really good at laying the foundation for future stuff because so much of what happens later on in the book or in the series is a direct result, sometimes like 3 times removed down the chain, but it's directly because of what happened in this book.
Which is why you could convince me, like I said, that after Moon Called, she planned out the rest of the series.
Yeah. Yeah, because, like, for example, like, how she gets sucked into next book's plot is because she used the Fae stuff to kill Andre as well, instead of giving it back to them straight away.
Have I read the Iron Druid? No, I haven't. How bad is it?
On a scale of like 1 to amazing, because if it's amazing, we might not read it because it's funner to do the bad ones.
God, I am like so not into the Covenants. I'm so mad about this series. But if that's all we have for this one, like I said, these are shorter and less bitchy because we like the books.
Yeah, I'm so glad I've actually finally fucking done this series. And I really want to get into the Alpha and Omega series.
Yeah, we'll do that too.
Yeah.
Like I said, if I enjoy her other series, this might end up being my favorite author so far. Because, like I said, for me, I typically like an author's series, but then I don't like another series that they do. So
yeah.
Anyway, that's all I've got.
Well, the good thing about Jennifer L. Armentrout, which is the Covenant chick thing, is you'll hate all of her series equally.
Oh, good. Great. So happy.
We should do
So tonight, after the mainstream, the mainstream, LOL, we're going to do the first Covenant book, Half-Blood, and the novella Demon that goes before it.
Yes.
And so that's what we're going to be doing tonight. So anyway, if you missed the Moon Called stream, again, there's a link to the book club playlist down in the description so you can see all of that. If you want to read my writing, again, there's a link in the description where you can read it. So that's all I've got.
Yeah, I think that's about it as well. It's it is what it is.
So we will see you guys tonight. Bye, guys.
Yeah. Bye.